What is No Child Left Behind? I have heard this term thrown around in the education space for years, but I never knew what it meant. And that's probably because I was in eighth grade in 2003 when George Bush signed this program into law. This is why I chose this topic for my final project in my school and society project at Sonoma State. For this video, I'm going to address my main questions I have about No Child Left Behind and also why is standardized testing so bad? I know if I have these questions, then other people might have them too. So I'm going to be alluding to several resources, which I will provide in the description below. And just know that these are real questions that I had before I researched the project. The first question I have, where did America get the idea or inspiration for No Child Left Behind? What's the point? In a New York Times Daily episode from December 5th, 2019, Dana Goldstein reports on where she believes No Child Left Behind came from. The bottom line, competition, that is, with other countries. She alludes to the year 1957, when the Russians beat us to space with their Sputnik satellite, and the technological advances of Japan and China. She explains that many countries in the world have a more centralized education system, meaning that the government controls the standards and the curriculum of the schools on the local level. So our leaders thought that would be a good idea to increase our math and reading proficiency, to essentially standardize learning, whether you live in a wealthy neighborhood, a low-income neighborhood, whether you have a disability, or you come from a culturally diverse background. What is the history of standardized testing in the United States? In Janelle Cunningham's article, Missing the Mark, Standardized Testing as Epistemological Erasure in U.S. Schooling, she explains that the roots of standardized testing go back to the Progressive Era. This was an era that brought a desire for efficiency and promotion of science and expertise. This is when the IQ test was developed and advertised as a scientific and unbiased method of measuring intelligence. 10 years after Brown versus Board of Education, there was a report called the Coleman Report. This report found that student outcomes were not linked to more money in the classroom, more resources in the classroom. What it did find was that teachers matter and peers matter, and also family background matter in student outcomes. The findings of this report resulted in less money being put into schools by the government, and instead standardized tests were developed and put more pressure on teachers and administrators to raise their student outcomes. In 1965, the federal government began giving money to low-income schools and districts. Schools are funded by property taxes, and there is less money for schools in low-income areas. Between 1965 and 2000, the federal government more than doubled the amount of money they were putting into schools, so they began to shift their focus to the content the children were learning. In 1994, a law was passed that required set standards in order for a school to get this funding. And in 2002, the Bush administration created the No Child Left Behind law with the goal of establishing uniform benchmarks for student achievement. So what were the policies of No Child Left Behind? George W. Bush described it as a hands-on approach to learning. The main focus of No Child Left Behind was testing. The program asked states to test children in grades 3rd through 8th in math and reading, and once in high school, also in science. There were other terms to the program, including teacher evaluations and federal funding for districts, but the main part of the program was this standardized testing, which was different in every single state. These tests were able to collect data on how different demographics were doing in the United States and basically put people into those boxes. If a school tested low, the government would carry out penalties until that school could prove adequate yearly progress. Progress was shown if 95% of the students took the test and showed improvement over the next year. No progress was made. The school was labeled in need of improvement. Penalties occurred every year a school did not make progress. Year one, parents can transfer their students to another school. Year two, tutoring is provided by the school. Year three, corrective action is taken. Year four, plans of school restructuring. And year five, the restructuring plan is implemented. So how did the No Child Left Behind policies affect what is taught in the classroom? Let's first preface this by saying that with No Child Left Behind, each school is scored based on the results of their standardized tests. Schools were ranked in their district, and everyone knew where their school was ranked because the media covered this. This put pressure on administrators and teachers to teach to the test. This is the main issue of No Child Left Behind. It changes the curriculum. It changes what teachers focus on. It changes the nature of learning. Teachers and administrators feel pressure to teach rote memorization and only stick to the subjects that are on the test, leaving out art, science, history. The individual nature of standardized tests inherently conceals the learning gained through interactive classroom and real-world experiences. This is evident in the fact that teachers must often teach students specific test-taking strategies and procedures. The results of just teaching to the test results in students not really learning. There's evidence that the practice of standardized testing in schools results in a lot of teachers quitting. New teachers begin their job, stay there for a couple of years, and then quit. And then other new teachers come in and they stay for a couple of years and then quit. Teachers don't teach for money. We teach for the reward of relationships and the ability to impress upon children good morals and habits and help them develop habits that will be with them for the rest of their lives. With the pressure of standardized testing, teachers don't have a chance to instill other things into their curriculum, like teaching good character or perseverance and grit. School test rankings and scores are publicized to parents, local media outlets, on the internet, and throughout the school district. If the scores didn't indicate improvement, the school's reputation is at risk. It can't help but raise a teacher's anxiety level. Recently, we read in a newspaper that a teacher was caught while helping students with answers during the test. The teacher was fired. Who is to blame? Having a better teacher is statistically linked not only to higher income later in life, but to a range of social results, including lower chances of teenage pregnancy and a greater tendency to save for their own retirement. If better teachers are what we need, why are we instead focusing our attention on standardized test scores? What else does standardized testing miss? Students are simply memorizing facts, not gaining tangible skills that relate to the real world. Children are memorizing math skills, reading skills that apply to the test. This decontextualized material is useless in the real world. This also applies to grades. Children have different learning styles, and learning theories have established that. A child may know the answer to a question, but not able to express it in multiple choice form. Some argue that we are just teaching children how to take tests, and if you've ever taken a test before, taking a test is a skill. You have to practice. If you have a 4-hour exam coming up, you have to practice sitting in front of the computer doing your exam for 4 hours. You have to practice taking the test. That's how you do good. And just because somebody doesn't do well on a test doesn't mean they don't know how to apply that material in other ways. These kinds of test questions do not promote critical thinking skills and the ability to solve real-world problems. Answering fill-in-the-blank questions or focusing solely on the minutia of learning will not create educated people. Many children get anxiety from testing. Many children form academic identities. If a student receives a poor score, that may stigmatize the student for the rest of their educational career. They'll believe they are a bad student in this area. Cognitive ability on standardized testing is the only knowledge that is accepted.
It doesn't matter if a student is a gifted artist, a loving caretaker, talented musician, or poetic writer. Those students are the fish being judged on how they climb trees because we say the end-all, be-all is college, or we're leaving students to the lowest skill level work.
Standardized testing does not test the whole student, and there are other forms of intelligence than these cognitive abilities. In Lisa Delpret's article, she speaks about children who come into her classroom with advanced critical and creative thinking skills. It is often the case that for children who are from poor communities, critical thinking skills are basic, yet we seldom seem able to connect that kind of knowledge to school problem solving and advanced thinking. So I've heard about this a lot in the education communities, but what is the deal with racism connected to standardized testing? So there are a certain type of student who has an advantage when taking a standardized test. And yes, those are our middle and high income students. So basically, you have these middle and upper class students, people who come from educated families, who have been in this system a long time, who buy the books and activities that we learn in school and teach them at home. And these things align with the American education system. They train their kids with these materials because they know that is what you need to succeed. In the article, Can You Hear Us? Voices Raised Against Standardized Testing by Novice Teachers, the authors argue that the tests are insensitive to the diversity of their student population. You have low-income students, or perhaps people who are coming from a different country and they don't know the American education system. The norm reference tests, although well-intentioned, give a distinct advantage to upper and middle-class students whose parents tend to be well-educated themselves. This leaves minority students less likely to come from homes where education is valued and resources are available to fail required exit examinations and drop out of school before graduation. Another way standardized testing is seen as racist is because it skews a bias towards one type of intelligence. What we call basic skills and typically the linguistic conventions of middle class society and strategies successful people use to assess new information, for example, punctuation, grammar, specialized subject vocabulary, mathematical operations, five paragraph essays, and so forth, are all conventions. Also, these tests are created by subjective administrators. They say there's no bias in the test, but the tests are making assumptions about what each child is learning at home and the experiences that have led to that knowledge. An area's culture and biases in a region are not taken into consideration when these tests are made. Even when using statistical tools to reduce bias, guarantees of a bias-free test form or content is not assured. Cunningham argues that standardized tests test capitalist ideologies, and that students of color have a set of knowledge, but they have to abandon it in order to adopt this new ideology if they want to succeed in the American system. Standardized testing does not account for family life. They overlook family situation. If a child has adverse child experiences at home, what kind of attachment style they have with their guardian, which matters. Parents' educational background, poverty rates, communities. A child has adverse child experiences at home and traumas around that. Standardized testing is a mechanism that aids in the system of structural racism in America. When teachers are teaching to the test. They're not teaching the real world things that students need to learn to succeed. This results in underrepresented groups working in low-income jobs and becoming the grease that keeps the institutions which orchestrate his or her oppression running smoothly. Cunningham explains that standardized testing is the result of capitalism. And in order to uphold this liberal capitalism, the country must prevent all other ideologies other than the dominant belief system. Standardized tests mainly test these dominant ideologies of our society that most middle and upper class families are familiar with. These children learn basic skills that our society deems important at home, whereas low-income students who don't learn these skills are labeled as behind or put into a special education class. Even more problematic, the knowledge that these children do come to school with is often viewed as a deficit rather than an advantage. I have seen far too many children labeled as too streetwise by adults who see their ability to solve problems with near adult sophistication as violating some preconceived notion of childhood innocence. Cunningham argues these practices systematically erase the knowledge of communities of color, preserving achievement for those who can master liberal capitalist knowledge formations. Erasure prevents alternate knowledge from achieving dominance, as those who fail to conform to capitalist ideologies and epistemologies are left at the margins of society. Such tests have marginalized low-income students and students of color, and will continue to do so as long as they are heavily relied upon as measures of intelligence and success. Another reason standardized testing is not good is that it makes the rich richer and the poor poorer.
Private companies like Pearson and McGraw-Hill, who operate off policy and legislation written by nonprofit organizations and lobbying groups like ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council, buy the next textbook, buy the next workbook, buy the next digital software package, the next teacher evaluation system.
So you make the poor poorer by systematically denying them the information and tools to succeed. But how do you make the rich richer? Well, this system is led by private companies who perpetuate a cycle of learning and that they say is helping the underserved communities, but it's probably not. In Joshua Katz's TED Talk, he explains how private companies keep a stream of income flowing from taxpayer money. And these are the companies that create the standardized tests. And when there is a problem in a school, these companies create programs and initiatives for the districts to adopt. So what are other methods of testing ability other than standardized testing? Teachers agree that student achievement can be measured by a combination of testing, class projects, self-reflections, research assignments, demonstrations, and displays. Janelle Cunningham mentions the FOK approach, or funds of knowledge. And this is teaching through the eyes of the culture of the students that you have in your classroom. It connects the education to their culture, and it's proven to have positive outcomes. Lisa Delpret gives examples of how teachers can do this in her article by teaching students about US government using black church structure, or teaching Shakespearean structure by first analyzing the structure of a rap song in a special ed classroom. Really, this is about building a personal relationship with your students first and applying appropriate knowledge with their backgrounds in mind.
All right, Elijah, sit in the chair, please.
Well, where are the marshmallows?
In the This American Life episode, Ira Glass asks a question that I also had to. What should children be learning in schools?
Here is one marshmallow. If you don't eat this marshmallow, and I'm gonna go, and I'm gonna come back.
And get another one?
Yeah, but you can't eat this one, okay? Okay. Okay, I'll be right back. Say, okay.
Okay.
Every resource that I mentioned in this report alluded to the same skills that were linked to positive outcomes in student education. These skills helped them in school and in the real world as well. They were not cognitive schools or the math, reading, and science rote memorization that standardized tests promotes. James Heckman, a Nobel Prize winning economist at University of Chicago, has studied this for years and has found that the skills that are most important in children are non-cognitive skills or soft skills and psychological skills like self-regulation, grit, self-control, conscientiousness, resisting impulse, keeping your temper, resilience, leadership, and curiosity.
Maria, are you coming back?
It is also worth mentioning that if a student has adverse child experiences or stress in their home, it prevents them from learning these non-cognitive skills. And who tends to have stress in their home? Low-income students. So the last question I had was, where are we now with No Child Left Behind? In 2015, we got the Obama administration signing the Every Student Succeeds Act, which was meant to amend No Child Left Behind with better tests and the
Common Core curriculum.
The Common Core program also failed miserably. In Dana Goldstein's report from the This American Life episode, she summarizes the results from No Child Left Behind. Take a listen.
And it found that American performance is flat in both reading and math since 2000. So this entire time period that we've been discussing, ever since George W. Bush was elected and No Child Left Behind, through President Obama and Race to the Top and Common Core and effort after effort to try to get American kids to do better on these types of international exams, American performance has not changed. It's stagnant.
So No Child Left Behind did not work. But what it did do was reveal the achievement gap between low-income students and upper and middle-class students. It also made testing more important. We still use standardized tests in school, and we took a break this year because of the pandemic, but the Biden administration is still going to be carrying out these policies. In the education community, there is a lot of talk about standardized testing, and there seems to be an end in sight. But these are important conversations that we need to continue to have in this country in order to bring real change into our system and real change for our children. Thank you.
Did you eat the marshmallow? Good job! Now you get
two!
Good job, Elijah!
Now you're gonna get me another one?
Do you wanna wait some more?
Really?
Can you do it?
Mm-hmm.
You wanna wait here for 10 minutes again? Are you sure? Okay!